appreciate you. We love the love that you have showed us on this time, and we know from so many of your encounters with Kadeem and your testimonies about your interaction with him that it was nothing but love. So to all his extended brothers and sisters and friends and family, we just want to tell you that we thank you on behalf of Ian, Bernadette, Iana, Tristan, and Travis. I'd like to extend a heartfelt thank you, and all the family members would like to again send a heartfelt thank you at this time. I'm also asking, if you're in the room and you have a cell phone, please make sure that your cell phone is on vibrate. Please make sure that your cell phone is on vibrate. And then also, if you have a seat next to you, if you can raise your hand. If there's an empty seat next to you, if you can raise your hand and you can assist us. There are some individuals standing in the back. We have some extra seats up front on the right, my left, your right. There's some seats. If you can just keep your hands raised high until someone sits next to you. And again, we thank you for your love and your outpouring at this time. We truly do appreciate you. And we thank God for the life that Kadeem lived, and we thank him for the opportunity that he has given us to experience Kadeem and the love of Kadeem. Amen? Amen. Amen. I'm checking the room. I'm checking the room. If you don't know me, I'm Kadeem's aunt. And today we're going to celebrate his life. We have so much to give God thanks for. Amen. While he was here, he pressed his way in life, and we want to make sure that we celebrate him real good. Amen. That's my amen, partner. If you don't know, I brought help. So every now and again, you're going to hear a hallelujah and an amen. And his name is Brother Stanley, and I love him. Amen. At this time, we're going to open with the Old Testament and then the New Testament. The Old Testament will be read by Menachem on point, Psalms 121, directly followed by the New Testament, 2 Corinthians 5, 1 through 10, read by Allison DeRoche. If you can please come at this time, Menachem. We'll start with the New Testament.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I will be reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 10, and it's in the King James Version. For we know that if our earthly house is of the tabernacle, we are dissolved. We have a building of God, an house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that morality might be swallowed up of life. Verse 5, now he that had wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also had given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore, we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. Verse 7, for we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according that he had done, whether it be good or bad. A reading from the New Testament, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 through 10. Praise him.
At this time, the Old Testament will be read by Crystal Smith.
Grace and peace. I will be reading Psalms 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over this family will neither slumber or sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore.
Praise the Lord. At this time, we'll have the prayer of comfort to the family by our pastor, Shirley Walker.
Praise God, praise God, praise God. Good evening. At this time, I just want to give honor to our Bishop, First Lady,
Amen.
And the pastors,
Hallelujah.
Other bishops, ministers in the congregation, and the faithful children of God. I also want to say to the family, Sister Bernadette, this evening, I want to extend my sincere condolences. I'm so sorry for your loss. And I can say I do know what you're going through at this time. May the God of comfort, the Lord Jesus Christ, I just want to read as it says to us in Ecclesiastic chapter 3, it tells us that to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. Is a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh. It's also a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love, a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. This evening we give praise to the Almighty God, the Lord God, the Father of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who himself is the God of compassion, the God of love, the God of comfort, the comforter. He himself is the comforter. And so we come humbly before him tonight and asking him, Jesus Christ, the comforter, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that this time of affliction, this dark tunnel that we're going through at this time, understanding that he has the light at the end of the tunnel and that he is the comforter. And we ask him today in the name of the Father, that he would comfort each and every one, every heart tonight, every afflicted heart tonight, that he would rest, he would rule, and he would dwell in your heart tonight, that he would take full control of the necessities and the needs of what we're going through tonight, that he would guard and he would keep your hearts and your minds in perfect peace tonight. We ask him also in the name of Jesus that he would keep every heart that is mourning from any kind of satanic damages that will come through grief and shock, that it will protect the physical bodies, the emotional mind, and every state of being, that he will be a guard, he will be a protector. He wants us to grieve, but as he says, everything in order. He does not want us to grieve as if we don't know where Kadeem is at this time. And so we're asking him to comfort. We're asking him to protect every heart. We're asking him to watch over and to keep every mind. And when the time of misery come, when the questions come, and the questions could be negative of why, we're asking him also to give answers that only he can give. We're asking him to protect also from any deeper pain and grief that would occur through this. We're asking him in the name of Jesus Christ, he himself, the Comforter, to continue to rest and to rule and to abide in all of your hearts tonight and always, as long as it's needed, in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen.
Amen. I ask that you stand to your feet at this time. We're going to take some time to celebrate and thank the Lord for the life that Kadeem lived. Come on, put a smile on your face. You had an opportunity to meet him. You had an opportunity to interact with him. You had a smile. You had a laugh. You had some conversations with him that you will forever remember. And I ask that you keep that in your heart. We are a chosen set. We are a chosen generation. Call for to show his all I require for life. All I require for life. God has given me and I know. Come on, say, we are a chosen generation.
We are a chosen generation.
Call for to show his excellence. All I require for life.
All I require for life.
God has given me and I know who I am. I know who God says I am. Hey! What he says I am. Where he says I'm at. I know who I am. I know who God says I am. What he says I am. Where he says I'm at. Could you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I came to celebrate Kadeem. Come on, turn to your next neighbor and say, I came to celebrate Kadeem. And I know it's a heavy time on our hearts, but I'm just asking if you can think about the favor of God over our lives, that we get to be on this side of the living land and we get to bless the Lord and we get to thank him for life, and not just our life, but I'm gonna say it all through the night, we get to thank him for the life of Kadeem. And I ask you for my nephew, that you don't just stand here and look at me in my face, but if you can just bless the Lord with me, if you can just stir it up on the inside, if you can just go a little deep for me and say, you know what, I know Kadeem would want to have a party. And some of you may be used to another kind of party, but we're going to take some time to bless the Lord. We're going to take some time to lift up his name. We're going to take some time to glorify the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm thanking God for the life of Kadeem. I'm thanking God for all that he's done. I'm thanking him for you in the room, because we don't know what tomorrow promise, but today we will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise will continue to be in our mouths. Put your hands together and bless him.
matter what you see now.
Can testify about the goodness of life, that can testify about his
You may not know, but you're standing next to a miracle. You're standing next to a trailblazer. You're standing next to someone that wanted to give up but did not give up. Come on, look to your left and look to your right and understand all your life he has been good. Oh, we bless you, we bless you.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. I know you as a father, I know you as a friend, and I will sing of the goodness.
Come on, this is your moment to testify. Come on, tell him, say.
All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Come on, tell him.
I love your voice, love your. Close like no other.
Come on, tell him.
I know you as a father.
I know you as a father.
I know you as a friend.
I know you as a friend.
And I will sing of the goodness of God. The goodness.
Can I hear the voice in the room just say, all my life, all my life, you have been faithful. And all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness. One more time, say, all my life you have been, all my life you have been faithful. Yes, he has, yes, he has. And all my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, oh, I will say of the goodness. You can keep putting your hands together and bless the Lord for his goodness. And we declare in this house, whether you believe the Lord as your Savior or not, we confess and we profess and we declare that his goodness and his favor and his mercy will run after you. That it doesn't matter where you go or where you turn, that his goodness and his mercy and his favor will run after you. Hallelujah, we bless the Lord. Hallelujah, we thank you, Lord. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. At this time, we'll be calling on the Emmanuel dancers. At this time, we'll call on the Emmanuel dancers, and they will bless us with a selection, followed by the reading of the obituary.
I used to be so broken, lost, empty. A heart with no beat, singer with no song to sing. So I know the feeling, the silence is deafening. But in your pain lies a blessing, a sweet and sour victory. So keep walking, 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 though it seems so far.
Better, better, better. to me. I know you're scared, your heart's bleeding.
Obituary reading for our beloved Kadeem Ian Lee. Kadeem Ian Lee was born on November 19, 1991 in Brooklyn, New York. He was the firstborn son of Ian and Bernadette Lee. As a child, Kadeem was rambunctious and full of energy. His parents had their hands full as Kadeem loved to play and did not waste an opportunity to get in some type of mischief. In 2010, Kadeem graduated from Pace High School, and he continued his studies at Medgar Evers College in hopes of obtaining a nursing degree, but you didn't know that about him, while simultaneously pursuing his certification in hemodialysis at Midwood Dialysis Center in Brooklyn, New York. Kadeem understood the importance of a strong work ethic, as it was instilled in him by his hardworking parents. Even though he began to suffer with seizures soon after graduating high school, he continued to strive. In fact, he turned it into a stepping stone and decided that he wanted to pursue a career in healthcare. His health was always at the forefront of his mind. Whenever you saw Kadeem, he was always with his bottle of alkaline water. and encouraged many of you in the room to ensure that you drank your Lviv. In 2008, as a high school student, he began working with Jayzana's home care agency as a medical billing and mailroom clerk. He worked there until 2011, when he took on a new role at New York Presbyterian Hospital in the Environmental Services Department. In 2015, he transferred to Brookdale Medical Center, where he became a part of the Dietary Aid and Environmental Service team. While working full-time at Brookdale, Kadeem worked part-time at the Environmental Department at Hartford Maintenance. Kadeem worked at NYU Langone Health Hospital in the laundry services until his passing. There he continued to demonstrate a strong work ethic and consistently volunteered for extra shifts. Kadeem made an indelible mark no matter where he worked and everywhere he went. Kadeem was as silly as he was serious. Although you could be met with his "about the business I came here to take care of" face, you also met him with the "ooh, I have something up my sleeve." Kadeem loved to joke and play pranks, and in many ways wanted anyone that connected with him to feel the joy he felt. Kadeem dedicated his life to his family. To him, family time was of the utmost importance. On August 6, 2015, his life forever changed when he was blessed with becoming a dad to a beautiful daughter, Dakota Maya Lee. He was very particular about what his kids ate and was especially down on Dakota about brushing her teeth. She's smiling. If you don't see her, she's in the front smiling. He made sure to teach his children to love and look out for each other. Kadeem was relational by nature. He valued his friendships, and his closest friends became his brothers. Their bond kept them connected through the ebbs and flows of life. On December 7, 2022, Kadeem departed this earthly life. His mark will forever be branded in our hearts, and he will be remembered for his drive to press against the odds, tower over every trial, and for his refusal to allow his setbacks to stop him from loving, laughing, and showing up in the face of trials. Kadeem is predeceased by his maternal grandparents, James and Dolly Selby, his paternal grandparents, Alvin and Edna Lee, and maternal aunts, Carla and Janice. He leaves his behind to cherish his memory, his greatest gifts, daughter, Dakota Maya Lee, and son, Kadeem Ian Lee Jr. His parents, Ian and Bernadette Lee, sister Iana, brothers Travis Lee and Tristan Lee, maternal aunts, Shoma, Sharon, Maureen, Shalina, and Latoya, maternal uncles, George and Ansel, married to Anna, paternal aunt, Shoma, paternal uncles, Harold and Edwin, and one nephew, Kyrie Lee. He also leaves behind a host of cousins, other relatives, and special friends, as we see expressed here in the room. At this time, we'll open the floor for some individuals that we have chosen to speak on behalf of Kadeem. We know that in the room, everyone would like the opportunity to come and give their heartfelt extensions of love to Kadeem. But at this time, we'll call some individuals that will be able to truly speak about who he is and connect you with the stories that they remember about our beloved Kadeem. And in this order, we'll have our Pastor John. And we just ask that every speaker, please hold it to 2 minutes, 1 minute for some. Pastor Glenn John, Sabina Bartley, Alfro Cockfield, and then Corey Fields. In that order, you can come to the podium.
Praise the Lord. I want to believe that protocol has already established, so I will not go through it one more time, but greetings in Jesus' name. For my 2 minutes, I'll tell a story and get out of your way. Consider the man whose friend enlarged his business. His sales had increased to the point that a larger warehouse and sales office was needed. Even though the move was a rather complicated and burdensome process, it was really a thing of to be celebrated. For this reason, the man sent his friend some flowers on the day of the grand opening. The flowers, however, were poorly handled, and the businessman received a bouquet of flowers that was intended for a funeral. It was accompanied with a card which said, "My deepest sympathy during this time of sorrow." When the man called his friend on the phone to wish him well, he was confronted with the error. "Why in the world," said the businessman, "did you send me these sympathy flowers?" The man went immediately to the florist to demand an explanation. "I am terribly sorry about the mix-up with the flowers," he said, "but I hope you will understand. Your situation is not half as bad as the one down at the funeral home. The folks there receive your flowers accompanied by the card which said, 'Best wishes in your new location.' Kadeem Lee, I leave these final words: best wishes in your new location. I'm happy to be part of everyone today, to be part of this celebration, and tomorrow, God's willing, I'm happy to witness your new address and your location, which you will be resurrected when that time comes. To the family, God bless. Be comforted by the words, and I know the preacher will have a lot to say about it. God bless you. Bye-bye.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Sabina Bartley, and I'm here with my parents, Michael and Patty and Bartley, and we just want to wish you guys all the wisdom and the strength and the peace that God has coming your way to do. Kadeem was the life of the party, and I see a few of you nodding, which means this is like the understatement of the year. But for me, more than that, he was Kadeem the protector. He was a second brother to me. I remember whenever we would come to his room downstairs, he'd say, "What's up? Take a seat. You think you can beat me in games?" And we would start. Even when we were walking down the street, as we would go get food, if anyone looked at us in any way, he would tell him, "Keep walking." He protected me. Someone who was not bound to him by blood. I can only imagine how strongly he protected those even closer to him, like his family, his children, and his best friends. Kadeem was always one to share, give love, and protect that love. Right now, we are here gathered in his passing, each of us doing the best we can under the circumstances. And I would like to leave you with this scripture, Corinthians 4:8. "We are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. God is with us, and we can count on him to welcome Kadeem with loving arms. Kadeem loved each and every one of us fiercely, and let that fierceness live on in our hearts and in our minds. God bless you and your family on TV, and God bless Kadeem the Protector.
Good evening, everybody. I say good evening, everybody. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. I greet you on behalf of my pastor, the Bishop of God Battalion Prayer Ministries, my family, our church loves Bernadette and Bernadette's family. When Kadeem called me, I answered, because he was the son of Ian and Bernadette. And when he called me, it might have been a situation that needed to be handled, and he knew to call me, and I did my best to handle the situation. Kadeem was bigger than life, and he enjoyed life to the fullest. So we should be having a little good time in this house tonight. Somebody say amen. Amen. Kadeem won't want us all crying and carrying on. He wants us to be happy. So, in my last minute and a half, there was a man by the name of Paul. He was an apostle. And prior to his conversion, he was a persecutor of Christians. He's one of those guys from Laventel. I thought that would get somebody's attention. Now, I'm not from Trinidad, but I've been quite a few. And people warn you, don't go to Laventel unless you know somebody and they are expecting you. But he was from Laventel, just to give you concept. He was a persecutor of Christians. He was someone that terrorized Christians before he was converted. But after his conversion, he got to a place, and even though he had planted churches and many people were converted by his message of Jesus Christ, in 2 Corinthians, he asked God to take the thorn out of his side 3 times. Now, this is an old gangbanger, someone from Laventer, who now is asking God to take just a thorn out of his side 3 times. But church, God said, my grace, not your grace, not your friend's grace, but my grace is sufficient for you, Bernadette, Ian. This is gonna be rough in days ahead, but hold on to his unchanging hand and he'll carry you through. God bless you.
Of Kadeem's NYU family, I will offer my condolences to his mother and his family. I first met Kadeem in 2011 at New York Presbyterian. I seen this kid in the corner, serious. I said, okay, he's about work. He's gonna get some work done. We got to talking, and I found out he wasn't just that serious. He had a lot of laughs. We often spoke, not just about work, about life. And I always told Kadeem, don't do this, don't do that. He'll just look at me and say, I hear you, big bro, I hear you. Fast forward to this May, I moved on and went to NYU, not knowing that Kadeem was already there. Once I saw him, I said, hey, the world is a circle for a reason. And we came back together like it was nothing. Kadeem was a hard worker. He always told me, whenever you need me, call me. But I knew not to call him in the morning because he didn't like the mornings. He was just working for his family and his kids. And to see his kids, you can see why. Beautiful. Just want to tell him, little brother, rest in peace. I'll see you later. Thank you.
Again, I know that we're all in the room and we would love to give our extension of love, and you'll have opportunities after the service and of course at the repast to give your extension of love to the family. At this time, I would like to call on our council member of the 45th district, our very own Farrah Lewis. She's not only our councilwoman, but she's a dear, dear friend to the family, and would like to give an opportunity at this moment to extend her love to the family.
Good evening, everyone. Bernadette, Ian, just want to share my deepest condolences with the both of you. And I want to remind you, Bernadette, that you did everything you could do for Kadeem. You are truly his protector, his provider. I remember getting phone calls from you because you always wanted the best for your son. And I want to thank you for investing so much into him, because he was able to give back to this room that you see today. He's a hero. You have to remember that. I just wanted to read this condolence letter on behalf of the City Council. To the family and friends of Kadeem Jan Lee Sr., every day that we walk on this earth is an opportunity to discover or fulfill our purpose, to love, inspire, teach, and empower others. Whether it is for a season or a lifetime, every person who crosses our path is meant to help us become better versions of ourselves. Losing family is a somber moment for which we can never fully prepare. Faith reminds us that in life there is a time for everything, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. May the memories and milestones that you shared with Kadeem serve as a guiding light in the midst of this difficult season. Kadeem Lee will forever be remembered as a thoughtful son, a dedicated father, and for his kindness towards his friends and his community. His memory will continue to live on through his children, family, and all others who knew him. As we stand in solidarity with you, Bernadette and Ian, may the outpour of love and words of encouragement give you comfort and strength during this time of sorrow. I would like to express our sincerest condolences on behalf of the 45th Council District in Brooklyn, my family, and myself. God bless.
At this time, Minister Monique will minister in solo, and followed the next voice you hear is that of our pastor, Arisami Courtney, who will have the eulogy.
To breathe, my heart is torn in pieces. It's my offering. Take me to the King. Truth is, I'm tired.
options are few. I'm trying to pray, but where are you? I'm all churched out, hurt and abused. I can't fake, so what's left to do? Truth is I'm weak, no strength to fight, no tears to cry, even if I try. But still my soul refuses to die. Oh, just one touch will change my life. Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. My heart is torn in pieces. It's my offering. Lay me at the throne. Leave me there alone to gaze upon your glory. Sing to you this song. Please take me to the King. Truth is, it's time to stop playing these games. We need a word for the people's pain. So Lord, speak right now, let it fall like rain. Oh yeah, we're desperate, we're chasing after you. No rules, no religion. I've made my decision to run to you, the healer that I need. Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. My heart. Lay me at the throne. Leave me there alone to gaze upon your glory and sing to you this song. Take me to the Lord. We're in the way. We keep making mistakes. The glory. Not for us, it's all for you. Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. My heart is torn in pieces. It's my
White X4 plate BTJ. J5090, white X4, BTJ5090. Please move your car. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Truly, tonight, Bernadette, Ian, we've known you a long seasons and seeing you walk this out. And just today, our hearts, our tears, our laughters, it's all with you. And as Emmanuel, Judge of God, you know you are honorary member here. A long time family member of this house. And to all the family and friends and loved ones, and this, I can just echo these words that say, it's not supposed to be this way. We can't understand it. We can't put it together. But I want to tell you that we're not hopeless. That God is with us. Now, I know that you have been sitting for quite some time. And because I need to make sure you don't fall asleep on me, and because I just want us to reverence the word of God, I'm going to ask you just to stand with me for a brief moment in order for us to just go into a scripture. And we know how many of you love Kadeem, that even our overflow is overflowing with people. And so we thank you. We thank you for being here this evening. The passage of scripture that I want to read to you today is really an illustration that I want to use today. And it's a story about a family. I'm just going to read 5 verses from the Bible. And we're going to talk a little bit, just for a brief moment, about this family, okay? And the word of the Lord goes as follows. Now it came to pass, we're reading from the book of Ruth, chapter 1, from verse 1 through 5. Now it came to pass in the days that when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, and he and his wife and his 2 sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife was Naomi, and the names of his 2 sons was Mahlon and Chilion, Ephraites of Bethlehem, Judea. So they were living in one place and they moved to another one because there was a famine in the land. And they went to the country of Moab and remained there. Then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, he died. And she was left and her 2 sons. And now they took wives and the women of Moab, of the women of Moab. The name of one was Orpah and the name of the other was Ruth. And they dwelt there for about 10 years. And then both Mahlon and Chilion also died. So the woman survived her 2 sons and her husband. Father God, we thank you for richly blessing your word today. We ask you to allow everyone to hear what you have to say to them this evening in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. All right, so now you got your stretch. Amen. Truly, as Latoya shared with us, if we were all given that opportunity to be able to say words, we can all say something. Just truly richly enriching of what we learn from the people around us, and especially in this season from Kadeem. And I believe that that's something that sometimes we miss, because sometimes we don't reflect on the impact that people have in our lives, the positive impact that people have in our lives until sometimes when they're gone. But we love Kadeem, and I believe Kadeem knows that he was loved. And so we are grateful that we know where he is. And so we are left here. And you know, the Bible speaks that it's good for us to come together. It says it's good for us to come to the house of mourning and come together and kind of reflect on our very own lives. So thanking you again for being here for Kadeem, and just to hear what God wants to say to you. And he has made this appointment for us, Kadeem, giving us the opportunity to be here this evening to share. I believe that we're all mourning. I believe that it's been not just a day, a week of mourning. It's been a season of mourning, if we be truthful. And then when we thought we couldn't take anymore, Kadeem is gone.
And it just paralyzed us, right? Wherever we were, because how could this be? Well, this family that I read to you about, the reason why I chose them in the Bible is because we read the story where this was a husband and a wife and their two children looking for a better place. You know, we've all come from different islands and we come to the United States for a better life for our family. And so they were in search of that because there was a famine where they lived. And here they show up, and as time goes on, this woman is left alone. Her husband dies, and then her sons die. And I believe I can hear her heart say, this is not the way it's supposed to be. You see, if we could recall, and I can't go into all of that, even that time, usually the men of the family will take care of the women. But yes, she found herself in this lost place. But today, and I believe one of the gentlemen shared it, I wanted to talk to you on the subject of hold on. And I believe, yes, when I heard the gentleman share it, I said, God, that's what you want to encourage everyone in this room to do. In this season, God wants to encourage you to hold on. See, I chose this story because it was a story that was sandwiched between turmoil, a season of turmoil in the Bible. And God chose this family that even though they went through this awful thing in their lives and this loss and experienced loss after loss after loss, loss of their home where they came from, loss of the husband, loss of the children, loss. This woman just experienced loss after loss. What God was about to do through her life was something miraculous. And I want to say to all of us that God, He is our creator. That God, He is the author and the finisher of our lives, of our faith. Amen. And so God has a purpose and a plan for every one of us. Amen. Now, life and time and chances, it happens to all of us. Just as these women were left alone in grief, that mental anguish because they lost their loved ones. That's where these women found themselves. They lost their protector. They lost their stability. They lost everything that was giving them a firm foundation. Truth be told, we're okay until you mess with our stability. We don't want this to be moved. We don't want that to go that way. We'll be fine. We laugh. We enjoy. But the minute you mess with our stability, and if you realize something, in the last 4 years of our lives, we have been living in constant instability. And we can't control what's going on around us. And that's the same type of season these women found themselves in, where everything was gone. And so now we meet them and they're mourning. And mourning is that place that as we are facing today where Kadeem is no more. Kadeem is not here. And it's a brokenness, and it could happen in our lives for any reason. It could be divorce. It could be you lost everything you had. And it's a place of grieving. It's a place of losing. You feel like you're just constantly losing. And that's where they find themselves. But I want to tell you something. That it is okay to mourn. It is okay to lose out. You know, the Bible says that there's a time for everything on earth. There's a time to weep. There's a time to laugh. There's a time to mourn. And there's a time to dance. That there are going to be seasons in our lives. But this mourning season could be very detrimental to us if we don't navigate it and manage it in the proper way. See, the Bible knows, God knows that we will be in mourning at some point, that life will happen to each and every one of us, and we will experience grievous losses in our lives, that we feel like we can't breathe, we feel like we can't think. But the Bible has promises for those persons who mourn. He says in Matthew chapter 5, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. God is with you, Bernadette. God is with you, Ian. God is faithful. He knows. He knows the pain. And then in Psalms, it says, God heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. In Romans, Paul says, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. There's a safe place and a safe time and a safe season for us to mourn. So what I'm here to encourage you today to hold on, to let you know that there's a right way and a wrong way to navigate the season that you're in right now. Amen. Because you could be mourning about multiple things in your life right now. But you can make it, because if the Bible promises that you can be comforted, if the Bible promises that he will hear you and he will bind up your wounds, that means you're not alone. Amen. That means you can make it through this season. You will never forget. You will always miss him. You can always laugh about him. It doesn't go away, but you can navigate it with God on your side. You see, psychologists said that there are different points of grieving, right? There's different ways that you can grieve, and they could be very healthy as you process and go through them. However, if you stay in any of them too long, it could be detrimental both to your physical health and your mental health and those that are around you, which is why it's important that you process, that you go through. And what I want to share with you is that the healthy biblical response, so that you can stand, so that you can wake up in the morning in your right mind, so that you will be able to function in what you're doing and not just be on a whim because you don't care anymore. That's hopelessness. God wants the people, and I know you all believe that God is God and God is real and he's our creator, and he knows what he has prepared for us, and he knows this earth is in the palm of his hands, and he loves us, and we are his perfect creation, and he has not forgotten us, and God has not abandoned us, but we have to come and look for him.
Amen.
He says he stands at the door of our hearts and he knocks, but yet we have to open the door for him to come and sup with us, for him to come and commune with us, for him to come and walk alongside of us and guide us and direct us. And what he's saying, he says, I don't want you to be in denial. I don't want you to be in anger and resentment. I want you to be honest. That's what he says. I want you to be honest about how you feel. I want you to be honest about what you're facing. I want you to be honest how this loss has impacted you. If you can begin to look at yourself and say, this is the place that I am. Amen. See, because God is asking you, where are you? Yes. Come to me. He promises. He says, come to me, you that are weary, that are burdened, that are tired, busted, disgusted. He says, come to me.
Amen.
But you not, unless you accept and know where you're standing, you won't think that there's a need to come to him. He says, be honest with God. Be honest with him and say, this is how I'm feeling. This is what I'm going through. Not only realizing where I am, but speaking to him and telling him, God, I need you. I need your help. See, there were a few men. You think that sometimes when we read the Bible or we hear about the Bible, we think, oh, everybody's perfect. They just, you know, they just doing their crazy thing in the church or whatever. I want you to know that the Bible is filled with human beings, life stories used in order to lead us and to guide us, and that we can have better choices and to show us the will of God for our lives, to give us that unveiling so that we will know what to do, how to do it, and how to walk. And there were real men. Hear this. David says to God, my God, my God, why have thou forsaken me? Why are you so far from me, from helping me? Don't you hear the roar of my roarings? Tell me that's not somebody being honest with God. God, I'm fed up. How many of us ever been through stuff where we're just like, we can't take it anymore. I'm done. Why you, God, where are you? If you're supposed to be a good God. But then hear what he says. He says, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel.
You see, he didn't just stay in the place where he was of mourning, of being frustrated, but he moved past that. He came and surrendered to God. There was another man that were going through some stuff, and they said, "My eyes mourn by reason of my affliction. Lord, I have called you daily, and I stretch out my hands to thee." He's like, "Where are you? In this problem that I'm having, I don't know how to think. I don't know how to handle it. I don't know what else to do. I ran out of options." And what he's saying, but in the end, he turns around. He says, "But unto thee I have cried, O Lord. And in the morning shall my prayer prevent thee." In other words, God, you're going to hear me and you're going to act on my behalf. You see, there's that place of faith, that place of you going through something, but you know that you're not alone and God comes. You can be honest and come to him and cast your cares upon him and lay down all your burdens before his feet. And then he will come and give you peace and walk with you as you're walking through the valley. People, you're not here by chance. You're here because life is real. You're here because things are happening out there that are beyond you, that are beyond what you can handle. But God says nothing can overcome you when you're under my protection.
Amen.
When you're under my wings, I'll walk with you and encourage you. Because you see, even the world that we live in, it's not helpful. The world that we live in is falling. Jeremiah was another one who was frustrated. And he says, "And thou hast removed my soul far off from peace." In other words, I'm in turmoil. But then he says, and I love how he says it. He says, "But this I recall, this I remember in my mind. Therefore, I have hope. It is the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed, because of his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him." Amen. See, God declares for us to have to seek him, for us to have to answer the call. Whatever you're facing, wherever you're standing, Kadeem faced every step. You saw he never gave up. There are moments sometimes in our life that we feel like we're not progressing, that we're not moving forward. But when you look back and then you see, no, but he did this, but he did that. And then you see, wow, he was, it's life we're living. It's life. And some days are down, some days are bad. But overall, we can't make it without God. This is what God says. He says, "I set before you, I call this day heaven and earth as witness against you that I have set life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live." You see, we try to do things in our own strength. We try to feel good, to look good, to have money, to have prominence, to have food, to have work, to have drugs, to have sex, to have alcohol. We strive to satisfy ourselves and do things in our own strength. But at the end of the day, we're still tired. Amen. And more debt. Amen. To forget we went shopping and now we have nothing. And more debt. But God is saying, "I'm telling you, my daughters, my son, that if you trust in me, if you depend on me, I'm giving you a choice. You choose." You see, it's not religion, it's relationship. He is your creator. He is your creator. And when we surrender to him, he will lead us. We don't have to fix anything. We don't have to plot anything. We don't have to do a hocus pocus about anything. If we surrender to God.
Amen.
And say, "I'll try this in my own strength." So that woman, Naomi, she heard that there was bread in the house that she had left. And she decided to go back. And when she got back, she said to them, "Don't call me Naomi, call me Mara, because it means bitterness." Yes. See, just as those men, she said, "I came back empty. I lost it all. I have nothing. God must have dealt with me harshly." Come on, how many of us feel that way? Like, okay, God, you just abandoned me. I'm just behind your back. You don't care for me anymore. She had gotten to that place just like those men were feeling the pressure of what they were going through. But you know what I love about Naomi and what I want to encourage you tonight? Even though she was feeling the way she was feeling, she was still in obedience that she was going to go back to God. She wasn't, she was empty. "I'm done. I feel like God dealt with me." But in her spirit, in her heart, she still went back to the house of God. And I want to tell you today, everyone, that I want to invite you to the house of God. And that is not a physical building. It is a place where you open the doors of your heart to God and you allowed him to come in and you allowed him to lead you, direct you. You see, the final stage of mourning, you can get to the point of depression. But here is the biblical way of doing it, is comfort. Is receiving God's help. And I want to declare to you tonight that God has shown up to give you help. And he's saying, "I'm here and I'm standing at the door of your heart knocking, telling you that you can have life, that you can have blessing, that you can have strength, that you can have comfort, that you can have peace in the middle of your storms. You will be able to stand if you allow me in." This is what the Bible says to you. He says he doesn't want us to be ignorant. In other words, when we live life doing things in our own way, we close our mind to what God wants to say. So therefore, we don't know the truth. And therefore, that means ignorance. We don't know. So what he's saying is that I need you to understand that those that have fallen asleep, some people don't have hope, but we have hope. I know there's a group of believers in this room that have hope and believe and know that Kadeem is in the hands of the Almighty God. Right? He says, God says, "I don't want you to be ignorant. There's a hope. He may not be no longer here in the physical realm, but he's with God in the spiritual realm. And there is a spiritual realm, and you can experience that too." And he declares it in Revelation. He says, "And God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. There shall be no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying. There shall be no more pain." In other words, God is saying a day is coming, a day is coming where there will be no more. But we must choose how we're going to live this life. The Bible says that we can have a life that's abundant. And I don't have all night with you, but if I could just say to you that it's not the things that we collect. It's not the things that we feel we're going to lose if we accept God. It is bigger than that. Amen. It is your soul. Hey, hey. It is your life. It is your heart. It is who you are. It is who you were designed to be. Do you feel that void sometimes that you're moving on and you're working hard but not accomplishing, and there's something missing in you? I want to tell you that's God. And I want to encourage you as I ask you to stand at this time.
The Bible says that God gives more grace to the humble, and he opposes the proud. Naomi had to make a decision. Her decision was to go back to her people. Even though she felt that she had lost it all and there was no hope for her, she still made the right decision. And she went back to the house of her God, of her people. And ultimately, if you read that book of Ruth, you see where God used her life in such a miraculous way that she became the great-grandmother of King David in the Bible. And I know many of you know King David. And ultimately, King David was the ancestor of Jesus Christ. Naomi thought life was over. Naomi thought she could do no more. Naomi thought it was over. Naomi thought that the hand of God was against her. Naomi didn't know that God was making provision for her every step of the way so that she can be back in alignment of who she was created to be. As our Pat Bishop comes to pray, I want to encourage you to seek God. To seek God. Because Kadeem's fight with illnesses, seizures, is over. His struggle with that is over. We're still here in the land of the living. But God with you, he will give you the strength that he gave him, the joy that he gave him, to still have a positive outlook for the future. And that's what God wants for you also. God bless you.
Hallelujah!
Glory. Hallelujah!
Amen. We thank God, First Lady, for those words of encouragement. My condolences, Bernadette, Ian, the entire family, and to his friends that have come and showed so much support, so much love. Kadeem was truly a special young man, and he is going to be missed. I remember the last conversation we had, I called him, I said, Kadeem, when you're coming out to our men's meeting? I said, Bishop, I'm not gonna make this one, but I'm gonna be at the next one. I'm gonna be there. Really love that kid. He will be missed. You know, the story that we heard today is a family that experienced death and loss, and truly this beloved family that I know very well have gone through their share of loss. And the English language cannot define or explain the pain that we feel when we love someone and we lose them. It's short on words to explain this feeling that we feel inside. Sometimes this feeling when we deal with this loss feels empty, feels painful. It's unexplainable at times. The hurt that we feel, that we will not have the opportunity to embrace this person again. We won't see them coming through the door, walking up the block. We won't see them again. And that pain hurts. And then sometimes we go through some mixed emotion, because sometimes we remember something they did that was funny. And then we begin to laugh and be joyful. And a few minutes after, we feel that pain of loss again. It's unexplainable. And I believe, from the young to the old in this place, you know what that feeling feels like. And it's even hard to explain it, because it's just empty. It's just painful. And it can't be fixed. And it causes us to know that we don't understand everything. And we haven't figured everything out. And there is so many unanswered questions in our life. And the life that we have to live. So many unanswered questions. But we have to go to someone that knows us better than we know ourselves. Someone that could explain these emotions that we feel inside. Someone that could give us some clarity of what we're going through in our life. And the only person that can do that for you is God. He's the only one that can reveal to you what you're going through. He's the only one that can comfort you and help you and continue to give you hope in this journey that is so difficult that we call life. I believe everyone here can agree with me that life is not easy. Life is not easy. Life is not a bed of roses. We have to deal with stuff like this. Losing someone that we love. What do you do when you feel all of that, all of those emotions inside of you? I want to encourage you today that you begin to see God not as a father that lives in another country that you speak to every now and again, but you begin to see God the Father as a father that holds your hand and walks with you through this difficult journey of life. God wants to be that father to you. He wants to be the one that holds your hand and walks with you through this difficult journey if you would allow him to. I want to give you that opportunity. Amen. I ain't asking you to join this church. I'm asking you to hold God's hand. Amen. And allow him to walk you through this difficult journey of life. Hallelujah. Because sometimes you don't know what you want to do. When you're going through these difficulties, you don't know if you want angry, you don't know if you're upset, you don't know if you're mad, you don't know if you want to run, you don't know if you want to quit, you don't know if you want to ball up in a ball somewhere in the corner and just weep and cry. You need God. God will help you through this journey.
Amen.
I want to give you the opportunity to tell him, God, I want you to hold my hand. I can't do this thing on my own. I'm in pain and I need your help. I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. If you desire to be closer to God, if you understand how limited you are because of situations like this, and you need someone to connect with that understands all things and knows all things, it's your God. Bow your heads with me. If that's you, I want you to repeat this prayer with me. Let him know that you're hurting. Let him know that you want to make a decision to invite him in your life. Pray with me. Say,
dear Lord,
I ask you to forgive me,
of
all my wrongdoings.
Forgive me of all my sin.
Would you cleanse me, Lord, and help me in this journey of life? I confess you as my Lord, as my King, as my Father. I ask you to walk with me in this journey of life. Come into my heart and live in me. And help me, God, live a life that is pleasing to you. I need you, God, and I ask for your help in this journey. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. Can you just put your hands together and give God a praise? Because just as simple as that, just as simple as that, you invited God into your heart and into your life. And he wants to walk with you. And if you open up your spiritual ears, you're going to hear him talking to you and guiding you and say, no, not that one. Come on, I want you to go this way. Come on, you need to stop doing that. Come on, you need to come this way. He's going to guide you and direct you. He's going to keep you out of trouble. He's going to love on you. He's going to fill that void of emptiness if you allow him to. I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you. I'm praying that God take you through this difficult season, because it hasn't ended. More is to come. So you need him in your life. My prayers are with you. And on behalf of the Emmanuel Church of God, I want to let you know that we love you.
Amen.
And the doors of our church are open to you.
Oh, yes.
At this time, we're going to call. I don't know if they have the video. Yeah. At this time, we're going to prepare for the video presentation. You may hold your seats for a few moments. And after the video presentation, the funeral director will be coming to prepare for the final viewing. We're going to ask you, this place is packed, so we're going to ask you to use discretion and not spend a lot of time in showing your condolences to the family. You can do that at the repast. So we're going to be asking you to come with the direction of the ushers. You're going to be coming to my left, your right, and you're going to exit my right to your left. We're going to ask you to stay out of the middle aisle when you're coming for the final viewing. Again, we thank you for your love and support towards this family. We thank you for being here. Your presence means a lot.
Amen.
God bless you and God keep you.
I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave
fall on my knees and rise.
As we prepare for our final viewing, we have a few cars that need to be moved. License plate H2D7223. It's a white car. KGA6414, a white Lexus. Another Lexus, J as in Jesus, F as in Father. P9270, it's a gray, and it's parked on East 26. You're blocking someone, a BMW white, JMJ3510. And finally, also parked on East 26, JEX8278. Please move your car.
Good evening, everybody. Before we have our final viewing, tomorrow morning, we're going to be meeting here at the church at 9 a.m. There'll be a viewing from 9 to 9:45. At 9:45, we'll be closing the casket, having our final prayer, and we're going to proceed over to Evergreen Cemetery, which is located on Bushwick Avenue. We're going to ask everybody who's coming tomorrow morning to please be here on time. We must be at the cemetery by Pacific time tomorrow morning. Also, tomorrow it's supposed to be very nasty and rain. Please dress accordingly. Directly after the viewing tonight, there's going to be a repast. It's going to be at K&L Manor, which is located at 4501 Glenwood Road. So directly after the viewing, we're going to ask everybody to please, as you pay your final respects, and you exit the aisle to my right, you can go directly over to K&L Manor and you can meet the family there. Because I know the family want to have a little bit of time for themselves here by themselves. So those people who are double parked that are outside, please, once you come up here and you pay your final respects, please move your cars because there are people that are at the restaurant that cannot get out. And we don't want to see anybody get any tickets. We're going to ask the people that are standing, please, we're going to ask you to come up first. You're going to come up my aisle to my left, pass the casket, and exit on the aisle to my right. Again, tomorrow morning, 9 a.m., we're meeting here. If you haven't signed the register book, we're going to ask you to please sign one of them. In the lobby, there are five of them. Sign each one. This way, we have an account of the people who have been here, so that the family can either at a later date just send a thank you card or give you a call. Again, we want to thank everybody for being here. God bless you all.
I stay no longer with you, but my pleasure's up.
my life. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life.
Born again, we say.
Born again. Thank God I'm born again. Born again. Thank God I'm born again.
Born again.
Thank God I'm born again. Born again. Thank God I'm born again.
They used to say, born of the water, spirit and the blood.
Thank God I'm born again. Born of the water, spirit and the blood. Thank God I'm born again.
Born of the water.
Born of the water, spirit and the blood. Thank God I'm born again. Born of the water, spirit and the blood. Thank God I'm born again.
Born again.
Thank God I'm born again.
Born again.
Thank God I'm born again.
Emmanuel name so sweet.
Emmanuel name so sweet.
Every rock
me rock upon Jesus. Jesus name so sweet. Every rock me rock upon Jesus. Jesus name so sweet.
Every rock me rock upon Jesus.
Jesus name so sweet. Every rock me rock upon Jesus. Jesus name so sweet. Emmanuel name so sweet. Jesus name so sweet. Emmanuel name so sweet.
Jesus name.
Jesus name so sweet. Emmanuel name so sweet. Jesus name so sweet. Emmanuel name. Rock me, rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet. Every rock me, rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name.
Every rock me, rock upon Jesus.
Jesus' name so sweet. Every rock me, rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet.
Shout the victory when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We will see and shout the victory.
I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll
And I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus someday.
I've got my mind,
made up, and I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus someday.
Goodbye world,
goodbye world, I stay no longer with you. Goodbye pleasures of sin, I stay no longer with you. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life.
I made up my mind,
to go God's way the rest of my life.
Say goodbye world,
goodbye world, I stay no longer with you. Goodbye pleasures of sin, I stay no longer with you. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life.
But I am under the rock, say,
I am under the rock,
hey,
the rock is higher than
Jehovah,
Jehovah hide me, I am under the rock.
Both tell my enemies,
both tell my enemies, I am under the rock, Jehovah hide me, I am under the rock.
Say, I am
under the rock.
The rock is higher.
The rock is higher than I. Jehovah hide me. I am under the rock.
Go tell my enemies.
Go tell my enemies. I am under the rock. Jehovah hide me. I am
Jesus
under the rock.
Jesus' name.
Jesus' name so sweet. Emmanuel's name so sweet. Jesus' name so sweet, Emmanuel's name.
Oh, Jesus' name.
Jesus' name so sweet, Emmanuel's name so sweet. Jesus' name so sweet, Emmanuel's name so sweet.
Every rock
me rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet. Every rock me rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet. Rock me, rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet. Every rock me, rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet.
Born
again. Thank God I'm born again.
Born
again. Thank God I'm born again. Born
again.
Thank God I'm born again. Born of the water, spirit and the blood. Thank God I'm born again.
Born of the water.
Born of the water, spirit and the blood. Thank God I'm born again.
Born of the water.
Born of the water, spirit and the blood. Thank God I'm born again. Born of the water, spirit and the blood. Thank God I'm born again.
I'll say
yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
I'll say
yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree.
stay no longer with you. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my
goodbye,
life.
Goodbye, goodbye world.
Goodbye world.
Is our God.